have enough for a quorum, so we're gonna go ahead and get started. It's 5:15. Call the meeting to order. Have you guys had a chance to look at the previous stuff that we discussed? Is that in here? I didn't see it.
No, the minutes weren't in there.
You didn't, you just went with it, right? So we don't have to approve anything from the last meeting then. Okay,
What do we need?
Backflow preventers, which I know we talked about that in Winfield the other day, about letting the irrigation people make the tie-in from the water service without having a plumber do it. And I think that was all agreed upon with us at that meeting, and I think even when we talked about it here, is that...
Yeah, I didn't have an issue with it.
Yeah.
Felt like that probably it'd be hard for them to schedule it, and that unless they decide they don't want to
do it.
If you don't have a problem with it, why would I?
Yeah. I don't have a problem with it, because like we said, that's them getting us at a short notice is going to be very slim.
I've done very many of them through the years, and somebody's been doing them anyway, so...
And if they're qualified to do the testing on backflow prevention, then I think they're capable of doing that.
And they're responsible for it.
And they're, I think they was going to talk about, well, they already have insurance, but to make sure they have the proper insurance, and did we talk about they have to get a bond for that or not? They already have a bond.
Are they gonna make them be licensed?
They're already licensed as a backflow preventer tester. Now, it's not nothing to do with the city.
It's not a city license.
Right, right. I don't, Winfield didn't have that, did they, or did they?
Yeah, I don't remember. I didn't think so. I think they just got permits when they did it.
Right.
So what's the main reason for having it in the first place?
I talked to Rod Haney earlier, and what Rod Haney told me, that he's gonna bring this up before the board too, and talk to them, his board, and fire out all the changes and everything with the licensing permits and all that kind of stuff. He just hasn't had time to do it.
So they are gonna make a license for the backflow preventers to make the tie-in?
That's what I understand.
You have to have a license to put in, to qualify it to be, or you have to go to school, I guess, to get some kind of schooling?
I think that was our recommendation, that they do have to have their backflow preventer certification before they're allowed to get a permit to do a tie-in and install their backflow. That's the way I understood it.
Right, yeah, I think so.
So if they qualify, they, yeah.
Yes.
So it's not our decision whether they have one or not.
Well, it kind of falls under the plumbing code, is there...
If they can't pass the test to do it, then...
Then they won't be able to pull a permit to do it.
So, yeah.
Yes.
I just don't want to see it in the paper again where we're being accused of being a butt because we done something and we didn't have any choice in it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which ain't gonna happen, but...
So do we want to allow them to do...
If they have their certificate, have gone through the class and have their backflow certificate current, I don't see a problem with it.
Right, because they have to be renewed every 3 years.
Yeah, I think every three, yeah.
Yeah. So do we want to put a fee on it or not? Just let them do the...
Well,
pull a permit.
Permit inspection's gonna be the $25, right?
That would be the...
So that would be the fee, I suppose.
Okay.
So do you want me to pull the permit under just a plumbing permit?
Yeah, because we don't have a backflow category.
Plumbing slash...
Haven't thought about that.
Well, there is, in the code book, there is backflow prevention, so do we want, I mean, what do we have to do to make a backflow...
I think it ought to be specific to it.
Yeah.
I don't think it ought to be a general plumbing permit.
So backflow installation.
I don't know if we could do it like as a, like a Class D B license, which would be 2 years, and then the qualifications being whatever testing and certifications that they have to have. And that they have to test that. Don't they have to test those like every year, wherever they install that?
Right.
So it's their responsibility to bring in their certifications and wherever they install it to test it and give us back that information.
Well, what worked good for the code enforcement?
What Trey said would work just for me. I mean, I'm pretty flexible on that.
Okay.
The only thing is on the testing part, I think the city has to have the records of where they put the backflow prevention at and what they did. And every year they have to have them tested. That way the city has the records of it to whether if they show, okay, this backflow prevention and yada yada happens has not been done yet, they can send a letter out, the city can, stating the backflow prevention has to be tested to meet requirements. And if it's not, well then, you know, the city would take action.
Right. Because the real water, it's not just the real water, KDHE is the one that actually is pushing this issue, which they pushed it before, but now they're really cracking down on it. So, yeah, I mean, whoever puts them in, like I put one in for Rural Water District number 4 just 2 weeks ago, filled out the paperwork, sent it in, but that's for them and they got it in their file. So, I guess, do we need a motion then to put them as a Class D? I'm trying to keep where we don't bill them an extra charge because they're
an
already
extra license.
Extra license. Do we have to have a motion to do that, or do we?
Well, if we want to use them just as a Class D, just to put it under the definitions on their Class D contractor, it would just be the $150 plus whatever permits that they need to pull. And they would really only need to pull a permit if they're installing the backflow preventer on a sprinkler. Like that'd be the only reason they would need to pull a permit.
Right.
Well, the sprinkler system itself, when they install it, either commercial or residential, do they have a license with and a permit with the city to do that?
Not as of yet.
So they can go out and put any system in. They just hadn't been able to connect it up to the city water system without a plumber doing it because he held the license and he could pull the permit. So we are going to have to come up with either a certain category, like you said, because if they don't have a license,
right,
they're tying into the city system,
yeah, they can't do
then it. They're going to have some sort of a license to do that. And if you want to make another category or you want to just fold it up into one of the categories we already have, then they probably would have to go ahead and pay for a license for that.
Right.
And then, so yes, I think that since they are tying into the city water system, then yes, I think there ought to be a license to go along with that.
Okay. You want me to put something together and
the criteria would be that they do possess a valid certificate for backflow prevention, installation, and repair.
Is there certain companies or like if I go to license a plumber or a contractor, they have, you know, the state recognized exam, is that the same? Or backflow preventers too, like.
Yeah, it is a state issued license.
Okay. Through what you said, KDHE.
KDHE and Kansas Rural Water Association, those are the two that I know of that put the classes on.
I think Fort Scott's the, isn't that where the main? Is that? HE or whatever?
I don't know if it's Fort Scott. I mean, when I went to Manhattan and took mine, they were all talking.
I did mine at Fort Scott, and I thought that's where the hub was at or something, but maybe not. Maybe it was just.
I think mainly out of Topeka, because that's where everybody come from that put this on.
So I'll put something together, and we can discuss it at our next meeting.
Okay.
Okay, that'd be fine.
Do you want a motion to table that for the next meeting?
I make the motion to table it so Therese can come up with a plan of attack and present at the next meeting.
Okay, do I hear a second?
Second.
Give a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, same sign. Okay, so that's tabled. Okay, tree trimmers. As you can see in our packet here, we've got the City of Wellington, how they do it. City of Winfield.
The City of Winfield, I got a question about.
Okay.
I wish Rod was here to answer it.
Which one?
Says City of Winfield tree trimmers. I see nothing in there stating where the homeowner can do it himself. If you read what was handed to us, it basically states you hire it done. And then if you go back to Wellington, they write all that, but they explicitly put in there that homeowner or owner occupant can do it. So forget Winfield. I mean, if we're gonna do it, I still want the homeowner to have that choice of doing it himself.
Right.
Well, we also discussed somebody made mention of like the college student just trying to, you know, earn some extra money or something like that, that we really didn't want to get into that.
You're not gonna stop that, even if you do have a license.
I think we mainly were just wanting to do, if they're an established business that advertises just for that work.
Yeah.
Right.
That was mine.
Well, if you read the paper last night, Ken had put that one little, you know, editorial deal that, you know, he kind of felt like it was being done for competition purposes. I don't think that we were trying to do anything to eliminate somebody in competition, because most of these guys all have their, there was only one of them that didn't have any insurance that came to the meeting. And
he's not into it full time anyway, as other
people. Yeah, but and that 4 out of 5 of them is recommending it, so I don't think the intent was to get into the homeowner and neighbor kind of thing. It was the people that actually have equipment to do that.
The people you'd call if you had a big job.
Basically
the qualified people to do it. So where's our?
I didn't see anything on ours here.
Here comes Andrew. He'll answer the question.
He'll put it in there.
What page are we on?
What he's paid for.
Is that what it is?
It's 4 pages from the back.
I think he's paid it.
New level?
He probably doesn't think so.
4 pages from the back, marked in blue, is the current proposed definition in the ordinance.
Okay.
The two things I always wanted to know, and you already answered one of my questions, which is that language about owner-occupant, we can certainly put that in there. And then just if we wanted to change the definition at all, you know, we don't mention we don't mention spraying or treating. Well, I guess we have treat on there. We don't have anything about spraying or pest control, which I saw those in Wellington and Winfield's code too, so we can add that, or if there's something you wanted to remove. But basically, I just want to make sure you guys were completely comfortable with the definition before we take it back to the commission again, because there was some discussion about it last time that we had it before them. But I think really that clause in Wellington's about allowing owners and occupants to do their own work on their own property, where obviously their liability is their own concern, and that's going to fall under their homeowner's insurance, should alleviate any of the concerns that the commission had raised, I really think.
Well, I didn't want to make it too complicated, you know.
I think you ought to probably put in there, though,
wherever the, about spraying. I mean, if you've got, see, City of Winfield's got treating trees or shrubs for the controlled pests within the city, and what was the other one? I know there was somewhere I seen that was, you know, spraying, which, don't you think? I mean, if you're gonna say certified to treat, then maybe that covers spraying, I don't know.
Okay. The only other thing I could see doing is maybe clarifying that it's the business of doing this or the trade of doing this, not just qualified, equipped, and certified. I thought we had that with firm or corporation, but just to clarify that it's commercial tree trimmers.
Yeah.
And not just, you know, kids doing a side business type thing. But other than that, I don't really have any other suggestions. It's just kind of what our sister cities are doing. I think those things should clarify it enough that it...
No, you're talking about item G in the blue?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
So what's in there right now is what we've taken before the commission previously, and I'm just looking at amending that.
Yeah, because they're, you know, like, Wellington kind of gets a little bit more in depth with theirs.
Well, the way theirs are structured, they have everything under each section, each kind of contractor, whereas we have it broken out. So everything about the application process, bonded insurance, termination, license certification, those are in separate sections of the ordinance. We just have that grouped together for all
Okay.
contractors. So we have a lot of that same language.
It's just...
I may go through that and just to see if there's any interesting ideas, but I don't think we're really doing anything radically different. The insurance amounts vary between the communities, but it seems like everybody was comfortable with the Class D amounts.
Okay.
And those
well,
are
I'm,
in excess, I think.
I think it's fine.
Those guys have more than what we're requiring anyway. So... Unless you guys have anything further on that, I think I have what I need for it.
Just want to see owner occupied put in there.
Okay, we can do that. I'm going to skip ahead to number four real quick before you get to camera stuff and just briefly outline for you what we did based on your direction at the last meeting. And I wish I had the page number. It's about halfway through the packet, the electrical code. You'll see a series of green passages. This is the amendment code language that Mike and I came up with. We just literally looked at the ICC book and amended it to try to match what you guys wanted. So I wanted to make sure you're okay with it before we take it back. Section 9 in the ordinance, section 1448 in code. So the first section there is what excludes garage door openers from the ground fault circuit interrupter protection requirement. So we added the exception to two. Garage door openers shall not be required to have that protection. And then we did the same for kitchens. Refrigerators shall not be required to have ground fault circuit interrupter protection. And then on the arc fault, there was a whole list of rooms here in a house that we took them all out except for bedrooms, closets, or similar rooms or areas. So Mike's concerns were just the areas where, you know, clothing and that sort of things.
Right.
So there was a whole slew of other rooms that were eliminated from that with this change. And trying to think what I may have, that shouldn't probably be in italics. It should show the old language. We'll fix that. So does that match what you guys were thinking from the last meeting's discussion?
I believe it does. That's what it
takes. I'm looking at you, Mark.
Yeah.
So are we.
Because I've never written ICC code amendments before, so I want to make 100% sure it works for you guys. You're the ones who have to follow this stuff and test on it. So, okay. And like I said, we did have that on the ordinance that we brought before the commission. They tabled it immediately. I don't know if they looked at it, but we won't change any of that.
Okay.
Do you have anything to add on the ICC? There were some other things that were in discussion, but I don't think we're ready to proceed on them right now. All right, so that takes us to second to last and third to last pages, section 29, the work performed by property owners. What I've done here, I've put back the proposed language from the city attorney that's in blue, and I'm going to let her talk about it.
You did say section 29, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Good evening.
Good evening. I requested that this be put back in here because I've had to be involved in
issues with people doing work on their own property. The main issue and why I think our code needs clarified is that we only require contractors to be licensed, and a contractor is defined in our code as, well, I'll turn right to it, I was going to summarize it, but someone that works for somebody else for money. So if you're doing property on your, or doing work on your own property, you're not paying yourself, you're doing it for free. So even as it's written currently, if you don't work with somebody else or work for somebody else to do work that's otherwise required to be licensed, you're not a contractor, so you don't have to be licensed. So, and that's the way I've interpreted the code. So really, I want something to clarify that ambiguity. And this is the language that I would like to see included that says, a property owner that's doing their own work is not required to be licensed, because I don't think the code currently requires them to be licensed anyway. And make it clear that plumbing, electrical, or mechanical work on their own property has to meet other qualifications. The code enforcement officer has to know that they can do it, they still have to pull permits and things like that. But to me, this actually restricts the work that people can do currently. Because currently, if you're not getting paid, you're not a contractor, you don't have to be licensed, and this doesn't apply to them at all. So to me, this provides more restrictions than our code currently does. And I've written a letter of interpretation to some people that had gotten a little sideways with code enforcement officers to say, this is how I interpret it, that if it's you doing work on your own property, you're not a contractor, but you can't hire anybody else. We had a situation some time back where somebody had a different business. They were working on property they owned, but they were having employees from their other business do the work. I said, no. If you're paying them to do the work, then they're a contractor and they have to be licensed. But then we added in that the property has to be legally titled in the owner's name, they can't be paid, and then nobody else can assist them. And then, of course, it has to comply with all applicable provisions of municipal code, the building code and technical codes, if that's applicable to the work they're doing. And I heard that you had some concerns about people that are just flipping houses, that maybe they do own the house, but they are just doing the work as fast as possible so they can sell it. And I think that's a valid concern. This is at a minimum what I would like to see, because I think it provides more restrictions than what we currently have.
Okay.
But flipping, I think we could easily include that it has to, we could include that it has to be their primary residence. If we do that, though, I think we need to change the definition of contractor, because contractor says they have to be working for somebody else. So if you're working on your own commercial building and you don't want to allow that, if you only want to allow them to work on their own home or a residence, then we need to make changes to other sections of code. So I'd like guidance from you on what you would like to see in the code.
I thought we were going to include rental property. As long as you own that property, it's not your primary residence, but it is the property that you own, you can perform work on it too.
Well, as I wrote it, you can clearly work on any property that you own, whether it be your commercial property or your rental property, but it has to be titled in your name. And the reason I wrote that is, for example, I have an LLC, but I can't go do, the way I wrote this, I wouldn't be able to go do work on any building titled in the name of my LLC. It would have to be titled Tamara Niles. So
okay.
Usually that I did that thinking for most commercial properties, it wouldn't then apply. But we could write, we can write whatever you want, really. And that's why I'm here, is to really get a grasp on what you want to see, and then we can make the changes to the code accordingly. And that's why I decided I should just come to the meeting, because Andrew would come back and I'd say, no, I think you should do this, and
right.
I thought,
right.
I'll just come here and we'll get it ironed out.
Well, didn't we discuss actually even letting the homeowner do his plumbing on his primary, not his rental property, but his primary residence? To allow them, if they've shown that they have knowledge, that you would allow allow them to do it, but they still have to pull permits and have inspections.
And that's what it says, the version in front of you, section 114-199B. It says a property owner may perform plumbing, electrical, or mechanical on their own single-family residential dwelling. But they could do things like.
Well, the first part says except plumbing, electrical, and mechanical.
Yes, and then that's why you go to B, that. So the property owners can.
Well, I never got past the first part. I was just looking at it. Well, why do you have it up there and then you counter it?
Because this is all work. So they could do windows. They could do the limited contractor things. They could do general contractor things. Anything otherwise requiring a permit, they could do on any property they own, except for plumbing, mechanical, or electrical.
Okay, I see.
And the way I wrote it, those three can only be done on your own house. So if you're going to do something that could really pose a danger, like screw up your own electrical work, well, then you're only going to do that in your house.
Right.
That was my
thinking. Not where somebody else can.
Right. Not when somebody's going to go shopping and a big fire is going to break out because you messed up your electrical.
I'm sorry, I didn't.
So, like, Tamara, what about, like, they want to tear down a wall that's structural in their house? I mean, shouldn't they still need to go get a permit? To just like
if,
I would have to get a permit
yes.
to okay.
If a permit's required, you still have to go get a permit.
Okay.
Just because you're doing the work yourself
doesn't mean.
And that's specifically in subsection D.
Okay.
All work performed shall comply with all applicable provisions of code, including permit inspection requirements.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
What about work where you might need a couple guys to help you? You'd have to hire a couple guys to help.
Well, then you better be a licensed contractor. Or they better be a licensed contractor.
I'd say most home remodeling jobs, you're going to need somebody to help
somebody.
You.
Yeah.
That's right.
And I've done this. I mean, I've worked
with
some
of you. Well, what
if
they don't pay them?
I mean, what constitutes being paid?
It's,
is this a cash form or is it buying them supper?
We have to go to the definition of contractor.
Beer, usually.
The contractor means. Anyone that does work with or for another for a fixed sum, fee, or any compensation. So if someone comes in to do the work and you're paying them, then you...
Technically, they're...
Mm-hmm.
they're
And really, to clarify it, we could amend contractor a little bit regardless. That says, really, contractor is anyone that does this work, not just that gets paid for it. Because that would be... even clearer that anyone that's doing this work, you have to get a license unless you're specifically exempted, and then the property owners would be exempted.
The only thing that I have an issue with on them doing on their own home, which Ken knows and well everybody up here knows, HVAC, you have to have an EPA certification to handle Freon. A homeowner cannot buy, well they can, they go online and buy equipment, which is illegal to do, but they do it. So here we're allowing the homeowner to do his own heating and air that he doesn't have a federal EPA license to handle Freon.
Two ways we could address that. We could add that to the plumbing, electrical, or mechanical. We could specifically list HVAC on there. But also D says they have to meet code required, including permit, inspection, and standards set by technical codes incorporated by reference. We could also put in any other applicable law. So if any law at all says you have to be certified to do this, that would.
That would.
Mm-hmm. Because they could go in and put their ductwork and things like that. They just wouldn't be able to charge up the system or anything. That would all have to be in, and then it's up to them to get a hold of somebody to do that.
Right.
And at my age, I got no problem with them hooking up the duck.
Yeah, if they want to hook up.
If they want to crawl under, hook it up, more power to them.
And if they put the wrong size in and it doesn't work, don't call me.
Yeah.
You know, but I mean, that's the only thing
that's
I see
thing,
about them is because there is a few laws that are out there that would definitely keep them from doing that portion of it.
Okay. So, but when you said somebody may need some labor to help them, and we can propose that to the commission. If you think a homeowner ought to be able to hire some person to help them do something, that's why I'm here, is to determine what you
want
to see happen.
It's
gonna get really, really sticky.
I don't know if we need to put higher, I think, you know, compensation maybe, you could take that out, just make a kind of a wage thing or something. I don't know how to do compensation. I mean, you know, you're.
Covers a lot of ground.
You work for brother-in-law and he does work for you, he helps you out here and there. I mean, in a way, it's compensating each other. So I don't think that ought to be ruled out. But, or we could just leave it like it is and then let them worry about it. I don't think police are gonna beat down their door if they know that they hired their, you know, paid their kids to help them or something, you know what I mean?
But we have run into issues.
But we would have the rules if they're stretching them.
That's why this is on, across my radar, because I have gotten involved in a couple of different.
But chances are, we'll never know whether they hired him or paid him or.
Right, and we'll let them do that under the table.
Right.
Hope the IRS isn't listening.
If you're gonna feed me, I want them in front of the table. I don't want them under the table stuff.
Compensation that paid, but.
I think that there's not any issues about family helping out family members, but the issue can be, or can arise, is you could have these landlords that have multiple properties.
Well, I can speak of somebody pretty quick on that.
They have people that they call up and they go do all their maintenance work.
Yeah, and they do all the plumbing.
And they have no licenses or.
And they have no license. Well, general maintenance, if it doesn't otherwise fall under the definition of a license required, is fine. It's when they get into the license requirement.
Well, chances are, those people ain't gonna pull a permit anyway.
Shocked.
No. Gosh, I said something that.
That has never happened in the city of Lincoln City.
You know, and you're not gonna stop it, so.
Yeah.
No matter what.
Let's say, leave it like it is, and then if it becomes an issue, we can address it later.
I think it sounds pretty good myself, right.
Well, and I think this is conforming practice. We're conforming code to what's currently happening. And sometimes that's.
Takes it a couple times to get it right, or get it how they want it, so.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
Do we need a motion on this, or is this all falling under number four, Andrew?
Are you gonna make any revisions, Tamara, to anything on, are you?
I would like to see a slight revision to contractor, in addition to the language I proposed in 14-199. And I reference that because contractor is any person that does work for money, and a property owner doesn't do that. And so technically our code doesn't prohibit anyone from working on any property for free. And so I would like to see a slight tweak to the definition of contractor that says whether you get paid or not, if you do this work, you're required to be licensed.
Okay, yeah.
And that's a safety issue, I think.
Right.
Unless if it's your own property and you want to mess it up and don't want to hire somebody that's licensed, then have at it.
Yep. Right.
That's how I feel anyway.
And then what was your idea then on the flipping of houses? Because I do know that's going on.
I think it definitely needs to be addressed.
I did bring in Phil's code in there that we looked at last meeting, so if you want to talk about that.
Because they had like a year or something that you had to.
Well, that's the way the Winfield was.
Yeah, own the property.
3 years. And we talked about maybe
3 years.
1 year.
Oh, that's what that was.
Give you an idea, too. In the last week, I've had two people that bought these houses at tax auctions. They've had them for a few months, and they're trying to sell them.
Yep.
That's a big problem with that.
So
the question is how much do you want to get involved?
I mean, like we talked, I think the last one is that, you know, if you're a contractor and you want to buy 15 houses a year and flip them, I mean, that's your business, you know, and as long as you're pulling permits and you're having, you know, plumber, heating and air and electricians and all that work on them, and, you know, and so then you're good. But for somebody that's not, it becomes like like we were just talking about. I mean, they're just gonna, they have all, everything's lined up for them in this, unless we make a provision on flipping houses. So it's like Mike said, it's already a problem. So, but how long, you know, they have to own it before they can.
I think they have to own at least a year. I would kind of push the 2-year market before they, because that's a business. They're mm-hmm. doing it to make money, to line their pockets.
Yeah. Yeah, because, I mean, if you buy, say, a $150,000 house and, you know, you put $50,000 or $60,000, whatever you do, and turn around and sell it for $300,000 or something, I mean, you put a substantial amount of money in your pocket right. just in one
but
house.
But if they're sitting on it for a year, I mean, they fix it up in 6 months, the bank's going to be, you know, wanting paid and stuff, that would hurt. I would think, I would be agreed to a year, maybe two. But
the way Winfield addressed it, they didn't say you have to own it for that long, but you're not eligible for permits for
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
So you could only do one at a time, or one
every
year.
3 years.
That's right, I remember that, so that's probably better stated.
Because then we would have to monitor when somebody sells a property and when they buy it, and I know I don't want to have that task. I don't know that any of you want to monitor mm-hmm. property records like
but
that.
But you would know if they're pulling the
permit. And the only downside is that then to get around it, people may try to not pull permits.
Yeah. Well, that happens anyway.
Mm-hmm. Or have 50,000 relation.
Well, do we want to go with 3, or, I mean, if that's the way y'all want to go, then do we want to go 3, 2, or 1, or how do you guys feel? You're more into that than we are.
I'm thinking a couple years is what I'm thinking.
Like 2?
I don't think it'd make a difference between 2 or 3. So I think 2 years would be great.
Okay.
Yeah.
That they got to keep it in their name for 2 years, or okay, we're not looking at the permit.
Well, they just can't pull another permit. If they sell it in 6 months, then they're allowed to do that, but they can't turn around and pull.
Get another permit.
In their name, I guess. It'd just be in their name, right?
Right.
Now, if they had like 2 people doing it, partners,
every year.
One could do it one time and the other one mm-hmm. could do it another time, right?
Yeah.
Yep. But anyway you go,
get another guy in there with them.
That's probably why they put it in as 3 years, because there are a lot of partner.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, so maybe 3 years then.
But if they're all under the same business license, then I mean, I'm not going to put it individually under, like, your Ace Construction. Your dad couldn't come in one day, and you come in the next time.
That's true. Yeah.
So. But if they own
but if they're licensed.
But they're two
Jim
different individuals.
Jim and Joe own a house together, and Jim pulls the permit to work on it himself. And then they buy another house, and Joe pulls the permit. I think that's more mm-hmm. what they're out. They're both on the property, so they could both fall into 6-7.
So what do you guys think? 2, 3?
Well, you need to word it where if they are partners, that neither one of them can pull it. I mean, if you can figure out they are a partner, doing a partnership type deal. I mean, I don't know, guys. It's tough.
And then what about their own house? I mean, if maybe their own residence, they can pull as many as they want, but maybe a house that they don't live in. Again, I mean, you can, the possibilities are endless.
Right.
I'm always thinking of, but if we do this, then we might think about this, but then it has.
Yeah, you could, you know, like a homeowner buys a house, fixes it up, he pulls permit to do that, and then goes out and buys a rental house, and he wants to fix it up, and then somebody comes up and gives him a good deal on it, so he sells it. It'd take him 2-3 years before he could pull another one and do that again. Mm-hmm. But if he pulled it as his primary residence, that would be separate from this, right?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Right. He can pull as many permits as he wants on his primary, his place of residence, if we, what we've accepted.
So we're down to 2 or 3 years.
I just go with 3. Doesn't matter.
Matthew,
I just go 3.
Uh-huh.
3 years it is.
All right.
So one, they can only pull permits for one address that is not their primary residence.
I don't like to say things at these meetings. I like to stay in the minutes, but what one of my concerns when it comes to the commission will be, the question will be asked, if somebody buys a house to flip it, and they hire, they do most of the work, but they hire tradespeople to come in and hook up the electricity, hook up the plumbing, hook up the AC, then does that become a flipped house because they've invested in the...
They didn't pull any pump permits, or license contracts.
The license contractors pull permits, right?
That'll work.
And I have done that on a house where I can paint and do some light demo, but I hired qualified people to do the real work.
I can't paint, but you know.
Yeah, but you don't...
But you don't want to either.
But you weren't pulling permits, because that's what they were for.
No, I never had to pull a permit, because I didn't do any work every year.
Yeah.
Okay.
I have one other question. You buy a house, you hire contractors, but you wanna do all the demolition yourself, so you pull a permit to demo. Does that stop her from, is it as long as all the other?
If it's not my primary residence, the language you suggested says I can only do that once every 3 years.
Okay.
I'm not eligible to get a permit for a different address until 3 years have elapsed, is how I would write that.
But if you went ahead and then demo the next one, and all the contractors did it, then you could do it?
Yes, or if you have a contractor that can, will pull a license and...
You work under...
And then you work under his, okay, all right, that would probably be a good way to...
We did some demo, and I would call Ace Construction and say, you need to come over and look at this before I do anything else.
Yeah, okay.
Right.
Probably the way to handle that.
I mean, it opens it up, you know, we're gonna have to be the discretionary of saying, oh yeah, I'll let you do some of this stuff, you know, but just like we said, you gotta, I gotta inspect it, Mike's gotta inspect it, so, you know, I mean...
Right.
I don't think it'd be a problem.
Okay.
Well, I don't see where that would, because you got more eyes looking at it that know what's going on.
Yeah, and that's the whole...
I really think about that situation where you have professionals that are involved in supervising, and I think we're talking about the situation where somebody wants to do everything themselves.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's when they could...
Can get ugly.
Take out the wrong wall.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
Everybody good with all that?
3 year.
Three year.
Three year.
And worded similar to what Winfield got.
Okay.
Okay.
I will draft some language.
All right.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay, so that basically covered number 3 and number 4, we've done those, tree trimmers, backflow we tabled. Any other, anybody have anything else they wanna discuss or go over? Yes, Mike?
Mike, I'll work on it, anything else too. I think I talked to Chris and some of Randy and everybody. On the solid decking in the IRC and the IBC, there's no description of what solid decking is. So what happened was that our code meetings that we had before, and we decided the 4-bay sheets of half inch plywood or OSB would be solid decking. The problem with that is, with the insurance companies, if somebody has an old roof and they go in there and the one by material can be solid up against each other very tightly, the way our code reads, they have to put solid decking on it. Well, that can go in there and that can increase the cost of that roof by $2,500 to $3,000.
Mm-hmm.
If the one by material is solid and tight, the way I look at it is that's solid decking too. But if there's any gaps in it, knot holes or anything like that, then that's completely different. And I talked to Chris about it, I think I talked to Randy about it too, and Mumford, and they all agree on the thing, but I'm just thinking, we're putting a burden on people that don't have the insurance coverage to take care of it, so I just think we ought to look it over and come to a conclusion on what's best for the customer, plus, you know, the city too.
Well, the code specifies the OSB and plywood, right?
Mm-mm.
No.
Just solid, no, solid,
just solid
sheet,
decking.
Solid
decking.
Decking, yeah.
And that can be one by material that's butted up solidly together, or it can be 4-bay sheet rock, not sheet rock, but 4-bay plywood or 4-bay OSB.
Well, I agree with you. I've seen underneath those old, you know, the houses built in the 60s, 70s. They've got one bys, but you know, you're up underneath there, they look pretty solid.
And the thing, I mean, if there's a gap in there, the thing is with the shingling, you run it in a row, the nails and everything, so if you happen to get in between the gap, you're not holding the shingles down. That's why it has to be solid, you know.
Yeah.
Front it up against each other very solidly.
So then define the gap.
A gap is anything that would
allow big?
Anything to pass through it. It cannot have even an eighth of an inch.
A piece of paper passed through it?
Mm-hmm.
Is that considered a gap?
That's considered a gap in my book. But that's the thing on it. It's costing people that
mm-hmm.
don't have the insurance covered. And a lot of insurance companies will come in and just say, you will put solid sheeting on it, 4x8 plywood or OSB. There's a lot of insurance companies like that. But there's a lot of insurance companies, too, that we have to send letters out to them stating that that's what we require.
Oh.
Because every town does not require it. Wichita does, and of course, Wellington and Winfield does too. I just had people come up to me. There's one lady, she had probably about 35 squares that was going to go on her house. It was an older roof. The insurance company gave her $1,800 to have it re-roofed.
Oh, God.
Yeah. And pretty close to $3,000 of that was the sheeting.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. This is going to sound dumb because I'm not in that business, but yet I'm one of them. I wish my house was built in the 60s instead of 1860. And yes, I have gaps on mine. So you're telling me right now we have to pull this 1x12, 1x14 decking that I have up there.
No, no,
you just go over.
You just got to go over.
Mm-hmm.
And I have to go over with half inch.
Well, yeah, well, by the table, what it says in the IRC and the IBC, yeah, there's a table in there telling you what you have to have on there for the decking. And usually it's at least 7/16 OSB or half inch plywood. And that's the way the code is written. Now, that's what we put into it when we had that code meeting. And I'm just saying that I feel that if it's solid with one body material, if the insurance company's going to want to do it anyway, power to them, that's great. But if they don't, and the people have to come up with that extra money, why make them do that if it's solid?
If, but how are you going to know that until they get the old roof off and the bed's already been laid?
That's, well, the thing is it's just like on most roofers, when they go in there and roof, that is one stipulation that if they get in there and they find one by material in there, then they have to go with the insurance company and have the prices changed.
Okay.
And what we do is I'll go in there and go take it all the way down to the decking with a felt paper off and everything, and I'll look at it and I'll check it and make sure there's no dry rot or anything like that on there. And at that time, we can look at the decking and see if there is gaps.
Do you allow, if they've got rot at the edge of the eaves, do you allow that one by, if it's good and tight, allow that to be replaced?
Yeah, that can be replaced and everything. But some of the towns have, they have a percentage, you know, of the roof, and usually it's like 10 or 15%. You can replace 10 or 15%
okay.
of the decking and go back on. Same thing with knot holes, you know, it can only be over a certain size. If it's over underneath that certain size, then you can basically put 10 over it
or something. Okay.
But anyway, just a thought.
Okay, well,
okay. Which is kind of back the way we were, the way we've done it for years. I mean, it's kind of discretionary, is that, you know, if you got big gaps, then you need to do something about it. But
99.9% of the roofers are going to find that. They're going to realize that, and if there's gaps in between that, they're going to tell the homeowners.
I can't nail it down.
Yeah, I understand that, but I'm sitting there thinking, why are you putting half inch on there if you're just filling a gap?
What do you mean?
Because it's got to be able to hold a nail.
Okay.
Eighth inch or quarter won't hold.
No, I'm saying 3/8. You still, same difference, but you still got the solid sheeting under there.
The thing is when you put the shingles down, Ken, the nails usually go in pretty much of a straight line if you're a good roofer. And if you happen to hit that gap, whether it's an eighth inch or even if it's a half inch, that nail is not holding into anything. Therefore, the integrity of that shingle is shot.
I'll drop it, but I still... what I'm saying is... Okay, you hit, it's no more than hitting the gap in between the two pieces of plywood. You hit that gap, don't you move it up or a half inch one way or next one on your next shingle?
The thing is hitting the gap in between the plywood, it should be butted up tightly anyway if they're putting it, installing it correctly.
Okay.
If they hit in between the plywood there, it's less of a chance of hitting the seams of the plywood than it is, say, a 1x6 running the length of the roof.
Yeah, every 5.5 inches, you got a chance of.
You got an 8-foot section there you're gonna hit.
Yeah.
So it's personal. I don't see any difference with it, but.
Well, that's why I'm bringing it up, because like I said, the sheeting thing is a, for somebody that don't have the insurance to take care of it.
Well, I understand that.
It's a big cut out of their money. And sometimes it makes a difference on whether they get a new roof or they live with a leaky roof and have mold and mildew inside the house.
Yeah, and mm-hmm. That's one thing I don't want to start seeing is that people are like, well, I just can't do it then.
Yep.
I'll just take my insurance money and go spend it at the casino and just let my house rot down. I mean, there's things that happen.
But here you come in 30, 40 years later, how do you know the sheeting you're putting down today ain't going to have gaps in it then?
Well,
it's just like the sheeting, the one-by material that was put in back in the early 1900s or whatever. I mean, it was quite solid sheeting. I mean, it was tight. Mm-hmm. But you get up there today and look at it from the attic drying it out, it separates. An eighth of an inch, quarter of an inch, up to a half an inch, I assume.
No, I'm not denying that. I'm just saying if you stop it here, like I say, I'll drop it.
So it's more like Chris said, it's a discretionary thing that you're just wanting to be able to allow that to happen should it fall under the criteria that you said.
Correct.
And, you know.
And like I said, a lot of the insurance companies, they require solid sheeting.
Yeah.
I mean, 4x8 stuff. Anyway.
Yeah.
There's other things we've ran into, too. You run into tongue and groove.
Yep.
And you run into shiplap, where it's kind of, you know, like this. Well, I mean, that under what we adopted under that code, that shiplap and that tongue and groove is not necessarily considered solid sheeting. And so that's, which we kind of talked about that, is that, I mean, really, that's solid sheeting. I mean,
it's more solid than two smooth ends butted together.
Yeah, exactly.
The tongue and groove, it can be used as long as it's an inch and a quarter and no wider than 6 inches.
Yeah, and see, and you run inch and a quarter is, I mean, a lot of the old stuff on the eaves, you know, where you had the open eaves and stuff, it's 3/4.
Yeah.
So that immediately exempts all that. So that's why I feel as if that this definition of solid sheeting, we should kind of revert to what Mike's proposing.
Okay.
All
right.
Thank you,
Mike. We don't need to vote on that or have anything on that. We just let
him do up to his discretion.
Do we need to make a motion to change that in our?
Well, but if we
you're just defining solid sheeting a little further.
Just all.
But we adopted the code for 4x8 sheeting.
Well, that's what I thought. I thought it was written specifically that'd be OSB or plywood.
Right.
When
we had our meeting in Winfield over the codes, that was brought up. So if it's written that way, then we have to do a motion to
change
and reverse it.
It was, but the thing is in this, I didn't see it in here either. Did you? I don't think you got copied. So if it's not copied,
didn't make the cut then.
That's good.
So we can still have gaps, huh? Sunroof.
Well, then if it is written that way, then we'll just have to address it at the next meeting and vote on it and be done with it.
Right.
Because we're all in agreement that that's a good idea.
Yeah,
so.
Right.
We'll look and see what we need to do.
Okay.
So we'll have to table that.
It's better to be a little wayward with it. And allow something like that, if it's solid enough, this gap is too much of a hazard.
Right.
To whether somebody can get a new roof.
Yeah.
Because that can make a difference.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Man.
You're looking at solid sheeting versus molding.
Well, then more than likely, the homeowner would go back to their insurance company and say, look, this is what I got. This is why we have to do it. Then they'll probably raise their monies to accommodate them to get a new sheeted roof on.
If it's not in their insurance package that they got from their riders.
Well, the roofer should be, put that in his bid, that should the sheeting, the decking not be tight, then here's the optional value, what it's gonna take to put that down.
And that's one thing we'd have to do, is let all the roofers know about that.
Right.
And carpenters.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay, anything else, guys, that we need to discuss?
Andrew?
Yes, Andrew.
Small annual freedom of information update. At the very back of your packet, you'll find a memo from the league. And I just wanted to have you guys to have this. I really don't think it's gonna come up as an issue, but you have gone into executive session in the past, so I just wanted to be aware of how the law changed a little. Basically, a lot of times what's happened is when there's exceptions in the Open Meetings Act to when you can do that. A lot of times bodies will just cite the exception and say how long they're gonna be in executive session. What we had transitioned to as a city is to get a little more particular about that. We try to say the time and place we will resume, because it's uncertain when you're, you know, starting that watch. And we'd already done that, and now the state's basically saying, yeah, you need to do that. But the other change is that they really clarified better that it's not sufficient to just say we're gonna go discuss non-elected personnel, or in your case, we're using our quasi-judicial exception. And you have to give some kind of a reason of what you're discussing. So, and you don't have to be specific, because a lot of times the reason you're going is to protect privacy, but just to cite a recent example, you would, if you had a hearing on a contractor like we've done before, you might have to say something to the effect of, go into executive session for quasi-judicial reasons to discuss the performance of a contractor, or to discuss the status of a contractor's license. That's really all that's changed, but I did want you to be aware of it. I know of one elected body locally that's already violated this since the law changed July 1st, so I just kind of want to give you guys the information. And there is a helpful thing on here that basically tells you how to structure the motion. Obviously cross out city council and say board, but basically that's really, read that verbatim and just fill in the blanks for whatever purpose you need. And we're always here to help with that stuff when it comes up, but that is the one real change in COMA this year that would possibly affect you. Tamara's here if you have any questions about it, but that's pretty much it.
Okay.
You guys have anything? You don't have anything on that, do you?
I don't.
Okay, you want to stop us halfway before we get into that problem?
All I know is I'm not going to help Kenry roof his house.
That's right, because I can't compensate you. I got news for you. Ken ain't gonna re-roof his house either.
Okay. I made a motion, we adjourn.
Second.
Second. Second. All in favor?
Yeah.
Aye. Opposed, same sign.